Hello, and welcome to memory addressing and CPU addressing modes, part of our TI Precision Lab series on microcontrollers. In this video, we will begin by reviewing high-level addressing concepts and then discuss CPU addressing modes. Addressing is the way that computers organize memory. Just like how maps and street addresses help us navigate cities, addressing in computers allows CPUs and the programs that run on them to access data in an orderly way. Here we have a diagram of a simplified CPU bus. The CPU uses the address and data buses to access information throughout the system. Each resource has a specific set of addresses allocated to it. This allows the CPU to address all of the system resources on the same bus. Keep in mind that this simplified diagram doesn't represent all microprocessor bus architectures. CPU designers may decide to use different bus architectures, such as Harvard or von Neumann. But the variations of CPU architectures like these are beyond the scope of this video. Addressing is so common in microprocessors that we sometimes forget that it's even happening. Let's go through a few quick examples to illustrate how addressing is part of common microcontroller tasks. In this first example, let's see how addressing works when the CPU configures a peripheral by writing the hex value 42 to the control register I2C control. I2C control, highlighted in orange, is actually a register within the peripheral block of the system. The address of I2C control is hex 4010. To perform this operation, the CPU sends the address hex 4010 on the address bus and the data hex 42 on the data bus. Keep in mind that this is a simplified representation of what is happening on the bus. There may be additional control signals that are not pictured here. In this next example, the CPU is executing the if statement shown. In order to evaluate the equality of global count in hex 21, the CPU must first retrieve the value of global count from RAM. Let's assume that global count is a global variable in a larger program. When the program was compiled and linked, global count was assigned an address in RAM. In our case, this address is hex 100. The CPU will issue a read to RAM at address hex 100 and then use the received data to complete the comparison operation. Let's explore one more similar example using C pointers. The argument val is a pointer, and it contains the address of the data. In order to use the value, the CPU must first issue a read from RAM. In this case, the memory address is hex 104, and the data returned is hex 32. In a CPU, the instruction set architecture is comprised of many different instructions. Here is a simplified view of an instruction. Within each instruction, there is an opcode, which describes the instruction's functionality. In addition to the opcode, most instructions will have one or more operands. An operand is the data upon which the instruction will operate. This could be a register or a location in memory. Looking at the encoding of an instruction, the bits associated with the operand will generally refer to data somewhere in the system. For example, if the operand is the contents of a register, the encoded bits will tell the CPU which register to use. If the operand is located in memory, the encoded bits will be the memory address where the CPU can find the data. We can think of addressing modes as the ways a CPU can access data in a system. Let's go through a few examples of addressing modes so we can get a better sense of how they each differ. The first addressing mode we'll discuss is often referred to as the register addressing mode. In this addressing mode, the operands are registers within the CPU. As an example, let's see how the add instruction would work when both the operands are addressed using the register addressing mode. First, the CPU sends the values of R1 and R2 to the ALU. Next, the ALU processes the data and returns the result. Last, the CPU writes the data result back to R2. This addressing mode is simple, and therefore fast, because all of the data was contained within the CPU. This next addressing mode is called indirect register addressing mode. When using this addressing mode, the operand is not stored in a register. Instead, the address of the data is stored in a register. To get this operand, the CPU will need to read the address in the register and then get that data at that address on the system bus. Let's take a look at the example with a move instruction. In this example, R1 uses indirect register addressing and R2 uses normal register addressing. First, the CPU will read the contents of R1 and use it as an address on the main system bus. Then, the CPU will retrieve the data at this address from the system bus and write it back to R2. Another type of addressing mode is called the immediate addressing mode. In this addressing mode, the operand itself is part of the instruction. In most cases, the immediate operand data will be in the data word directly after the instruction. If the operand for a particular instruction doesn't ever change, then you may be able to hard code it using the immediate addressing mode. As an example, let's see how an add works with this addressing mode. First, the CPU reads the word after the instruction. We'll call it immead for short. Next, the CPU sends immead and R1 to the ALU, which computes the result. Finally, the CPU writes the result back to R1. The indexed addressing mode is another type of CPU addressing mode. It is similar to another addressing mode called symbolic addressing, or sometimes referred to as PC relative addressing. This addressing mode has elements of both indirect register addressing and immediate addressing. In this addressing mode, the address of the operand is calculated by adding the value of a register with an offset supplied with the instruction. Let's use the instruction bit X to explore how this addressing mode works. In this example, the first operand uses indexed addressing, and the second operand uses register addressing. First, the CPU computes the address by adding the value of R1 and the offset. In this case, the offset is stored in the word following the instruction. Next, the CPU reads the data at the computed address. Finally, the CPU performs a logical AND of R2 and the data. The results will affect the status bit of the CPU. If you were to substitute R1 with the program counter, this addressing mode is often called symbolic or PC relative addressing. Symbolic addressing allows code to refer to other nearby code without having to know the absolute address of the code in memory. This style of addressing is used heavily because software frequently needs to access nearby memory at a known offset from the program counter. This is a key feature that enables position-independent code. Now that you are somewhat familiar with the concept of addressing modes, let's take a look at some actual C code and the corresponding assembly. This function computes whether the input's pointer dereference value is odd. On the highlighted lines, the processor is executing a move instruction using immediate and register addressing modes to load R15 in preparation for the bitwise AND. To perform the bitwise AND, the instruction uses indirect register addressing and register addressing. The address of val here is stored in register R12, so the instruction uses indirect register access to get the operand. In summary, in this video we covered addressing basics, we introduced the core concept of addressing modes, we explored a couple examples of how specific addressing modes work behind the scenes, and we finished reviewing a small code example. Thank you for watching. To find more technical resources and learn more about TI microcontrollers, visit ti.com/microcontrollers.